Well, thanks very much for that introduction. It's a pleasure to be here. Sometimes it seems like it's easier to get to low Earth orbit than here to Pensacola, just because of scheduling. And part of that's because I'd hoped to get here earlier and help tell this story before you'd seen the IMAX film. We were still producing the IMAX film. But, you know, I ended up changing jobs. And basically, it all comes down to Hubble. The last 12 years of my astronaut career, one way or another, centered around working on the Hubble Space Telescope on the ground and in space over three missions out of my five. And, you know, I just fell in love with the program. And so this last mission, last May, in fact, I landed yesterday, 1 year ago, with the crew. We tried very hard. We were supposed to land 3 days ago, a year ago, and we tried to get to Florida. We tried to get to Florida, and the weather just didn't cooperate. In fact, the guys in Houston would give us reports a couple of times a day, and they'd say, well, we think the weather's getting better. You know, we see a few holes. And keep in mind, this is a group of weather forecasters who live in Houston forecasting the weather at the Kennedy Space Center. And the guys in Houston work in a building with no windows, first of all. So, but it's about, you know, human-machine cognition and visual systems. But, you know, aside from that, what do they think? We don't look out the window? You know, we're flying over Florida. We see the entire state. We see Georgia, Alabama, the Gulf. You know, and we saw this huge air mass thunderstorm over the state that wasn't moving. In fact, we started to detect the counterclockwise circulation. Flying over at night, all we saw was lightning. And we thought, you know, why don't they actually tell us that there's no hope we're coming back to Florida anytime soon? But it was great. We got a couple extra days in orbit, and we ended up landing in California. You know, and it all worked out fine. But you know, hopefully we'll get Atlantis back tomorrow morning in Florida. I watched the radar just a few minutes ago, and there's a lot of thunderstorm activity moving that way. But I think we have a good window. But after that mission, when we're back on the ground, that was the last space shuttle mission to the Hubble Space Telescope. I decided that the science that Hubble's doing and the opportunities that it offers are just too cool to pass up. And so I've moved to the Space Telescope Science Institute, which operates Hubble for NASA and all of the science that Hubble does. So it's still a very high-performance team and a lot of fun. And Hubble really does extend our vision. You know, again, it's very much like some of the talks you may have heard here from people who are involved in human-machine cognition. Hubble is a robotic telescope, and it can see because of its sensitivity and also because it sees in wavelengths that are broader than what we see. We see in visual light. The Hubble can see all the way from ultraviolet light. You know, if you look at a prism in a spectrum, the prism breaking up light into its colors, and you start at green and you go all the way to blue and then violet. If you keep going, that's ultraviolet. If you go the orange, the yellow, orange, red range, you get into infrared. Well, Hubble can see from the ultraviolet to the infrared, so it has super vision. Superman vision. And plus, because it's in space, it has a very stable platform, so it can stare in one place for a long time and see very deep into the universe, and it's not disturbed the way telescopes here on Earth are from, you know, gears and trucks and earthquakes and things. So phenomenal telescope. But to give a little bit of his perspective on this, you know, why do we even study astronomy? You know, it's a very ancient thing that we do. People have wondered about the universe, I think, as long as we've had the capability to wonder. We've looked up at the stars, we've pondered our origins, and so astronomy is really about answering very fundamental questions. But from a human perspective, you know, I like studying astronomy because it's very fun and exciting. You know, you get to learn cool things, you get to go to neat places like low Earth orbit, work on amazing telescopes. You know, even just, you know, a parent and a child in the backyard with a telescope, you know, sharing that experience of vicariously going out and exploring the moon is something that's really exciting. But it does try and answer deeper questions that we have. You know, I call them cool questions. You know, where did the universe come from? You know, that's kind of a basic question. If you want to know where we came from, you know, you got to start out with where did the universe come from? How about the atoms that make us up? You know, we're made up of a little bit of water. Water is hydrogen and oxygen. Hydrogen was formed in the Big Bang. The original explosion formed a lot of hydrogen. But what about oxygen? Where does the oxygen come from? We're carbon-based life forms. Where did the carbon come from? It had to be made somewhere. You know, and we know it's not made in China. It's one of the few things that's not made in China. You know, where did those come from? And I'll describe some of that. And then you get down, you know, there's a long list of basic questions like that. You know, how did the planets form, stars form, galaxies form? And then the biggie at the end there, you know, are we alone? You know, that's also an astronomical question that we can answer with telescopes eventually. We don't have the capability now. But if I had given the same talk 20 years ago, I would have been able to describe a universe that was filled with billions of stars and 9 planets. If I'd given the talk 5 years ago, I'd only be able to talk about 8 planets. But we now know of over 450 planets in solar systems outside our own. Other planets are on nearby stars. And those are the easy ones. The number is growing. So in our own galaxy of about 400 billion stars, there are probably 10 times that many planets. You know, that's our estimate. Planets are extraordinarily common. 20 years ago, there was a big debate. Are solar systems and planetary systems extraordinarily rare? And there was a bunch of folks on that side. Or are they very common? And it turns out they're very common. So astronomy helps us answer these cool questions. Now, the Hubble Space Telescope is named after Edwin Powell Hubble, shown here. This is actually the 48-inch telescope on Mount Palomar, which Edwin Hubble never used. This is a totally opposed photograph. The other thing is, if that pipe was actually lit, they wouldn't have let him anywhere near this telescope. But it's a very stately pose. Anyway, so Edwin Hubble, who I'm sure you know him because of his fame as a field and track star, right? He was Illinois State champion in the high jump, a record that held for many years. It was like 6 feet 3 inches. And then, of course, he was the power forward on one of the best collegiate basketball teams of all time. I'm sure you know that as well. National champions 1908, 1909, 1909, 1910, the University of Chicago Maroons. You know, I'm sure in the Final Four you saw, well, anyway, so he was on that team. So he was a star athlete. But he's best known, of course, as the most famous American astronomer of the last century for doing a couple of interesting things. So keep in mind, this is only 80 years ago. 80 years ago, we lived in a universe that we knew was filled with stars, but we had no idea what its structure was, whether it was expanding, contracting. We didn't even have that in our vernacular. Einstein had posited a theory of general relativity that had solutions to mathematical equations that allowed for universes that were expanding or contracting or were static. And everybody worked in the theoretical physics community, they worked very hard to make sure we lived in a static universe, one that has existed for all time and that would exist for all time and that was uniformly distributed with stars. You know, that's the universe that we thought we lived in 80 years ago. Well, Edwin Hubble, on large telescopes at the time, 100-inch refracting telescopes and early reflectors, 40-inch refracting telescopes, 100-inch reflectors, was exposing glass plates that had been coated with photographic emulsion under these telescopes. He'd look through the eyepiece and carefully guide the telescope for hours at a time. And when he then developed those, or one of his assistants developed them, he saw things like this, as all astronomers did. And he was curious as to their origin. So what you see here, the black dots, this is a negative image. Well, in fact, you know, we have Photoshop these days. We don't have to look at that. Okay, so here's the positive image of a black and white photograph as we would see it. Here's stars, okay, lots of stars. And then there were these fuzzy objects called nebula. Why? Nebula, it means cloud. And so we saw these nebulae all over. And he was trying to figure out what they were. And in one of these, he found a variable star, which we recognize is called a Cepheid variable. It doesn't matter. But it pulsates, and its pulsation rate is proportional to the luminosity. So by measuring how long it takes to pulsate, you know how bright it is. If you know how bright it is, just by the 1 over r squared relation, you know how far away it is. And so if we know that we have a 100-watt light bulb, and you show it to me, and it's a meter away, I can say, okay, I know that it's producing this much light at 1 meter. If you took it 10,000 meters away, I know that if you take 10,000 squared, it'll be that much dimmer. Well, he computed how far away that variable star was and found out that it's extraordinarily far away, that this fuzzy object is not nearby and it's just a cloud of gas, but in fact, it is at such great distance that it could only be accounted for by this being a collection of stars, of billions of stars, at a great distance. And so he and others discovered that there were these island universes, in fact, composed of individual stars at fantastic distances. So using physics, he was able to look at the velocity measure the velocity of that that galaxy and others. And he discovered that, on average, all the galaxies were moving away from us. Now, back in the Greek times and even earlier, and you know, throughout much of modern history, we've always assumed that the Earth is at the center of the universe. I am living now in Baltimore, and so if I go a little bit south of Baltimore to some place called Washington, D.C., everybody who lives in Washington, D.C. assumes that Washington, D.C. is at the center of the universe. And we have to dispel these common myths. And so, you know, the mathematicians, early mathematicians, Ptolemy, Copernicus, you know, all these folks tried to reconcile their view of the universe with this idea that the Earth was at the center, and it always failed. And so Hubble's a smart guy, and he knew that Galileo was persecuted for his whole life by promoting this idea by the church, and was exiled and persecuted. So, you know, he was very careful in his observations, but came to the conclusion that, in fact, the observation is that either the Earth is at the center of the known universe, which would be a remarkable, or the solar system is, remarkable conclusion, or every point in the universe is equally the center and the universe is slowly expanding. So he and others discovered that not only were these island universes, we now call them galaxies, but that the universes and the galaxies are moving apart and that they're expanding, with the tremendous conclusion that if the universe is expanding now, at one point it must have been in a tiny ball. And so they discovered that the universe started in this so-called Big Bang. Now, if the entire universe was, you know, nothing but a ball of hot energy and started expanding and it made a sound like a Big Bang, was anybody there to hear it? But that's a philosophical question that we won't address tonight. But anyway, so just 80 years ago, we learned about this universe we live in. And then here we are 80 years later, and we're working with this amazing telescope, the Hubble Space Telescope, that has done things like confirm the existence of massive black holes in the center of galaxies, that's observed the atmosphere of a planet around a nearby star and determined what it's made out of, what the atmosphere is made out of, that has measured the expansion rate and the age of the universe. If you want to know what the age of the universe is, it's 13.7 billion years old, good to about 1%, and has seen galaxies in their earliest formative times, looked back 13 billion years in history and seen what galaxies look like, and I'll show you some of those pictures. But just 1 year ago, myself and my crew went up to the Hubble Space Telescope, and in the IMAX 3D movie, which I do encourage you to see, it's a lot of fun. I don't get a royalty off of it, but we were the film crew for that. It was a lot of fun to make, and it does, because of the 3D, give you the closest experience that I can tell you is like being in space. You know, being in space is the best, but if you can't do that, at least seeing this movie gives you the kind of the bird's eye perspective and the through the helmet perspective that we had doing the spacewalks. And plus, they have good music. But the other nice thing about the Hubble 3D movie is it tells the Hubble story in a way that in 42 minutes and 30 seconds, you know, you can kind of get the whole story of, you know, the building of the telescope, the launch, the disappointment, the first fixes, the science, and the science visualization scenes are absolutely the best. And I'll describe that if I remember, or somebody can ask me at the end why that's so unique. But for this crew, this was the fifth mission. Now, the mission was originally canceled. How many people remember that in 2004, in the news, it said, you know, NASA's killing Hubble, basically. So a few hands are going up. So when that happened, I was chief scientist, and nobody asked my opinion. Probably because they knew what it would be. But you know, I recognized when there was a battle worth fighting and one not worth fighting. And so the battle that I took up was not to try and reverse the decision, because from my position I couldn't do that. But I said, how can we keep Hubble operating longer to save it so that maybe somebody else can revisit the opinion? And perhaps we can be creative and send up a robotic servicing mission. And we could have done that. But we could not have done nearly what we did on this mission. On this mission, STS-125, the 125th flight of the space shuttle, we did a complete Hubble makeover. It was commanded by Scott Altman. This was his second trip to Hubble, his fourth space flight. And I recruited him because I knew he could do the job. He was the commander on the mission, shuttle commander on the mission before in 2002 that I flew on. I also recruited Mike Massimino back. He was the only crew member available from that previous mission because I wanted somebody else who knew the spacecraft, the Hubble spacecraft, and I knew could do the spacewalks. And then everyone else on the crew were first-time flyers. So Megan MacArthur is a physical oceanographer from Scripps and UCLA. She was flying her first mission. She operated the robotic arm and was the flight engineer. Greg Johnson, the pilot on the mission, you know, we have a commander and a pilot. Early on, the astronaut said, well, we don't want a pilot and a co-pilot. The co-pilot gets, you know, a lousy billing. So we have commander and pilot. But Greg Johnson is a naval aviator, flew A-6 attack aircraft, ground attack aircraft, on his first flight. My spacewalking partner, Drew Feustel, exploration geologist, actually a seismologist, on his first flight, he was my partner. We did EVAs, five spacewalks, extravehicular activities, or EVAs, spacewalks 1, 3, and 5. I was the Hubble commander, payload commander. And then Mike Good on his first flight. Mike Good is back in space, hopefully to land tomorrow. And he did two EVAs on this flight that was just up, installing batteries on the International Space Station. So that's our crew. So around about 2006, Mike Griffin, a new administrator, was able to say, hey, we don't need to work on the robot mission anymore because we're going to send a crew back, and he announced this crew. And we worked very hard to make a case that we could go back safer than we had done on a previous mission. In fact, people often ask, you know, after Columbia, you know, why did you go back into space? And the answer is actually pretty clear. This was the safest space shuttle mission I ever flew because we learned a lot from Columbia, made improvements, and so here we are going back to Hubble. Now, it's been billed as the most risky space shuttle mission ever, and I kind of disagree with that. The previous missions were much riskier. We just didn't know how risky they were. Now we know how risky they are, and we're scared, and we should be. This is risky business. But anyway, so in order to fly this mission, we actually had two spacecraft, Endeavour as a rescue mission, ready to go on the pad, and Atlantis. So with two space shuttles on the pad, we actually had to make sure we went to the right one. That one says Atlantis. You know, turn left at the sign, not right. So here we are going out in our orange launch and entry suits on launch day. And you never really know you're going to launch, it's a very complex business, but in fact we did. Those orange suits are mostly to make us feel better. You know, I'm not really sure you could actually jump out of a space shuttle and survive. But Scott Allman went in first. And then Greg Johnson and Megan went in last. They closed the hatch. So after 7 years from the previous mission, delays, cancellation, finally we're on the pad. The main engines light about 6 seconds before launch. That's when you know the vehicle's alive. Solid rocket motors go off, and the first thing that happens, we get a master alarm. That's a bad thing. But we continue. We're going uphill. About 30 seconds later, we got our second major alarm. And again, that's not a good thing. But we continued uphill. And so at 2 minutes, the solid rocket motors come off. These are cameras on the solid rocket motors, and they get to watch us keep going to space. 8.5 minutes, so they actually re-enter, splash down in the ocean on parachutes, and they're picked up off the coast of Florida. There we are, heading off to space. 8.5 minutes later, we jettison the large liquid oxygen, liquid hydrogen tank. That will burn up in the atmosphere over the Indian Ocean. Open the payload bay doors, and we're safe on orbit. You know, I talked a little bit about risk just then, and you'd think, you know, all that training and everything, and we're on the launch pad, and the space shuttle lifts off, and the first thing that happens is a, you know, major malfunction. It was actually an electrical short that announced the alarm. And fortunately, our training is pretty good. It was in a flight control system. Now, the space shuttle has to actually fly initially. It's an airplane going up through the atmosphere, so the wings are generating lift. How many naval aviators out in the audience? There's probably at least one. So a few. Anyway, so it's a flying vehicle. So we have to alleviate the loads. If that doesn't happen because the flight control system fails, the wings rip off. That's kind of a bad day. And so you don't want that to happen. But the shuttle designers were brilliant. They put in four systems. And so the trainers would often fail one in the simulations, knowing that it would be a nuisance alarm, not really a critical failure. But in fact, it was a real failure. So I didn't worry too much about that. The second alarm went off because the indications were the center main engine was failing. And we were actually talking about it before the alarm went off, that we started seeing erratic readings, the pressure was going down, and we said, this doesn't look good, because if the center main engine had failed that early, we would not have been going to space. We would have been doing a very risky maneuver called a return to launch site abort, where we fly up, burn off as much fuel as we can, turn around, fly backwards through our rocket plume, and then jettison the tank and try and land back in Florida. Never been done. Engineers say it's about a 50-50 probability of survival. But I wasn't thinking about, you know, some death-defying, you know, abort maneuver. I was thinking, I can't believe, and this is with, you know, a lot of vibration and noise and everything, and we're still trying to follow, you know, the normal trajectory. I'm thinking, I can't believe after all of this, after the Hubble cancellation, you know, after putting the mission back on, all this training, you know, that we're not going to make it back to Hubble. But the ground said, you know, continue. It would have been nice if they had said, you know, it's a sensor failure, don't worry about it. But they just said continue, which at the time meant, to me it meant one of two things. Either it's benign and we don't need to worry about it, or there's nothing you can do about it, you're going to end up aborting, and we don't want to scare you early. So, but fortunately we got to orbit and they said, we weren't worried about that. So we got to orbit. So immediately once we got to orbit, we converted our space shuttle from a rocket ship to our spaceship on orbit, got out of our spacesuits into regular clothes, and started chasing down the Hubble. So we launch into a slightly lower orbit than Hubble, which means we're going a little bit faster, and we catch up underneath Hubble until the Hubble Space Telescope is right next to the shuttle with matched velocities. We're flying in formation at about 17,800 miles an hour, as it turns out. And Scott Altman could then take the controls of the orbiter and look out the window, look at Hubble, and go right up underneath Hubble so that Megan MacArthur could reach out with the robotic arm and just grab it. And he did a great job. You know, Hubble looked like it was just motionless out the back window, and Megan was able to just reach out with the arm and grab it. So that's the grapple fixture.
Houston, Atlantis. Hubble has arrived on board Atlantis with the arm.
Atlantis, Houston, we copy. Nice job, Megan. Nice job on the Proxop flying as well. It's great to be back with the telescope.
So there we are, grabbing the Hubble. And you can imagine the pressure on Megan. First space flight, multi-billion dollar telescope. You know, if she bumps the telescope accidentally before the grapple fixture is firmly attached, you know, it could start Hubble tumbling, and, you know, and she was just calm as a cucumber, cool as a cucumber. So here we are. This is the shuttle robotic arm. It's about 50 feet long. On Hubble, there's actually two spots that you can grab it. It's a special little pin that's designed for it to be grabbed. And so Hubble is about 45 feet long. You'll see a little later when the spacewalks pictures are there how big a person is, but about that tall. These are the solar arrays. This is the end that would normally look out into the cosmos. And this is a view out one of the shuttle overhead windows. Now, the shuttle is a wonderful spaceship, really, truly wonderful. And one of the reasons it's great for people is all these windows. You know, when I got out on the West Coast at Caltech, it took me 3 years to get a window with a view. When I got to NASA, it also took me 3 years to get a window with a view, but this one was a lot better, looking out the window. So while we were installing Hubble into the payload bay of the shuttle, Drew and myself were getting dressed for spacewalking. And so the spacesuits are little spaceships in themselves. Inside, we wear these white garments. There's tubes running through the garments where cold water is circulated. That's how we keep cool, temperature regulation. We have pads because the suit's got a lot of hard points in it. These tubes are what air runs through. There's a helmet. And you can see it's a little tight on the middeck of the shuttle, you know, where we're storing all the gear. And that's because we not only had to carry up all of our spacewalking gear, so we had seven people on board. We had four spacesuits, which is like having four more people, and they're big spacesuits. And then we had repair equipment in case we had a problem like Columbia, the leading edge of the wings. We actually had little bits of the wings. And then we had tile repair in case the tile was damaged and all kinds of tools for that. So all these bags are filled with all this extraneous equipment that we might need for an emergency. And then we also, because we could be stranded in space with a problem like the one that happened in Columbia, we had food for 23 days stowed away, which is about the longest we could stay on orbit. After that, the lights would go out and it would get very cold, and, you know, that would be the end of us. So we had all that kind of stuff. So it was pretty crowded, but we got dressed in our spacewalking suits, got buttoned up in the airlock. So there, if you can see, that's me. That's Drew. This is before the first spacewalk, Scott Altman. Now, the commander normally doesn't get to go outside. Now, if we had to be rescued, he would have done one of the spacewalks to get to the other space shuttle. But it's kind of a general rule, the guy who can land the shuttle, we don't put him outside just because he's got an important role. And this is right before we started letting the air out of the airlock, so I highly encouraged Scott Altman to head back in, which he did. But these spacesuits are really amazing. We have lights, so we can work at night, high beam and low beam. And then there's little cameras here. So you'll see in a little bit the view from those cameras. So this is the wide-angle camera. So when you see one of the views in the video coming up, it was taken with one of those cameras. We have the ability to scrub carbon dioxide with a canister out of the suit, electricity, oxygen, comm system, all that kind of stuff.
Okay, John, you can open the thermal cover.
Okay, so
this is the start of the first spacewalk. I'm in the airlock. Just open the hatch. You can see those lights. This is the airlock assembly. And I'm opening just Velcro.
Thermal cover is open, Mass.
This is great, John. We see you coming out. You can egress.
Coming out. Ready, Drew?
I'm ready, John. Let's go do this.
Okay, so you can hear I'm a little bit pumped. You know, I'm ready to go outside. This is the sort of ceremonial picture, come out of the hatch. You can see I have a huge grin on my face, you know, wonderful spacesuit. I feel so comfortable in those suits, you know, as if I could do anything. All of my tools. You can see the reflection of the Earth. Here's the shuttle wing, you know, the blackness of space. Just a phenomenal, very magical environment. And, you know, I've trained for this essentially my whole life. You know, taking apart, you know, equipment as a kid, putting it back together, working on cars. You know, this is what I love to do. Going out to the telescope. So here I am. Here's Drew. Drew is on the end of the robotic arm now in a kind of ski binding-like device. And our first job is to take out the old wide-field camera, the digital camera on Hubble that's made all these beautiful pictures. How many people have seen the Eagle Nebula picture, for instance? Hubble picture, famous picture. That was taken with this wide-field camera, and it was time to upgrade it to a new digital camera. So this was the number one science objective on the mission was to put in this new super-duper digital camera. And it's also the simplest task on the telescope. So we wanted to do the easy thing, high-priority thing first. And Drew has a wrench here, and he went to release the one bolt that you unscrew to take this thing out. Again, the simplest thing. And it wouldn't budge. I mean, not at all. You know, and we tried, you know, pulling a little bit harder and harder and changing tools.
Again, before we break the A-latch, which is a game-ending activity, we ought to try that short adjustable.
Okay, here we go.
I think I got it.
It turned. It definitely turned.
Yep, it turned.
Okay, so this was the last-ditch effort. This was, okay, Drew, you know, just put everything you got into it, and there are two outcomes from that. One outcome would be the bolt would come loose. We'd take out the camera. Everybody would be thrilled. The other outcome is that the bolt would shear. And we actually had a torque limiter, a special torque wrench, in there to prevent it from breaking. Because if the bolt sheared, we'd never get the camera out. It was designed to be safe on Hubble, but we'd never get it out. Now, the way that you know you would shear it, break it, is the wrench would turn just like that. Unfortunately, it's also the same signature if it came loose. So at this point, we still don't know. You know, so I was not particularly excited. This was, you know, the low point of my professional life right at this point. But fortunately, we have lots of help. You know, it's not just me and Drew out there doing the spacewalks. Inside is Mike Massimino. He has the actual checklist with all the details, and there's a whole section of what to do if things go wrong. And it says, okay, if the bolt doesn't turn, change wrenches. If that wrench doesn't work, go to another wrench. If that doesn't work, you know, try this. And we have, you know, most of this book is for the things that go wrong. But we also can call the ground. There are hundreds of people on the ground. Hundreds of people on the ground that can. How many people have heard car talk on National Public Radio, right? So you never know. I mean, you reach out, you know, where you can. But fortunately, we didn't have to do that. So when we put the power tool on, and I say it's moving out, actually I said yoo-hoo.
It was tougher to do than we thought, but you know, it has ended with just beautifully. Well, I've just lost 5 years of my life, I think.
So that's the senior project scientist for that camera. You know, he thought it was the world coming to an end if we couldn't get that out. So fortunately, that went well. We replaced a computer on that first spacewalk. We installed a fixture on the bottom of Hubble so that a future spacecraft can grab it when we go back to Hubble. And that closed out that first spacewalk, EVA number one. On EVA number two, we had another relatively simple task to change out the gyroscopes on Hubble. Now, these are just little tiny gyroscopes. They spin at about 70,000 revolutions per minute. And they tell us, you know, when Hubble is drifting a little bit, what rate it's drifting, so we can correct it. This is part of what allows, you know, Hubble to point so steadily. You know, if I were aiming this laser pointer, and I was on top of the Empire State Building, and one of you was on the Washington Monument with a dime, Hubble would be able to hold that laser pointer steady on the dime over those hundreds of miles. So it's the most amazing system. Part of that system uses these gyroscopes. They're just a small box, and we had to change those out. That's the same task I had done in 1999 and had been done in 2003. So this is one of our routine tasks, or so we thought. So we had to stick Mike Massimino right into the telescope. There's great scenes of this in the IMAX. Here he is reaching up, doing some connectors. And you'll see this is Mike Good's bird's eye view, now Mike Massimino's bird's eye view from the camera. Here's one of these boxes coming out. And so the first one came out easily, and the new one went in relatively easily. In fact, we improved on this mission. We designed a new tool. Actually, my son and I designed a new tool and in our garage, which was then made into a flight tool. I think the flight tool was a little more expensive. And that's Mike Good, you know, thrilled that the first gyro went in easily. Unfortunately, there were three boxes, six total gyros, two per box. The next two didn't go in very easily. In fact, they gave us lots and lots of trouble. At the end of 6 hours, which is the normal length of an EVA, we had just finished those three gyros. But fortunately, the ground let us continue, and we changed out Hubble's batteries. These are not AA batteries. They're nickel hydrogen batteries. They weigh about 400 pounds each. But they're amazing batteries. They've lasted 19 years on Hubble, and we just put a new set in there. Every orbit, you know, we spend about 60 minutes in daylight and then 36 minutes in darkness, and these batteries are what keep Hubble going on the dark side. Hubble observes day and night because it's shielded from the sun, looking out at the blackness of space. So we did that on EVA 2. EVA 3, we put in the second scientific instrument. So we took out this refrigerator-size instrument called COSTAR, and this is the instrument that had the corrective contact lenses that repaired the mirror shape. Now those contact lenses are built into every new instrument, so we don't need this anymore. And we put in something called the Cosmic Origins Spectrograph. It's a new instrument that does the physics of stellar objects and galaxies. It breaks the light into its component colors, and I'll explain that a little later. But these weigh about 800 pounds each or so, and so I convinced Drew to go to the gym every day for 3 years, lifting weights to get in good shape, and it pays off, although of course it's in free fall, so it doesn't weigh anything. But it does have mass, and so if you start it moving, you gotta have the strength to stop it. But more importantly, working in the spacesuits is very taxing. They're very stiff. You're like the Michelin man. And you actually have to do work, the integral of FDX, physical work just to bend your arm. It's like curling a 25-pound or 30-pound dumbbell to do this with your arm, even if you're holding nothing, just because of the pressure wants the suit to do that. So it is physically demanding. But we replaced these instruments, and then we tried something that had never been done before on orbit. We repaired an instrument inside the telescope that had failed. And to do that, we had to take off cover panels that had dozens of tiny screws, cut through aluminum grids, pull circuit cards out. And many people said that this would be impossible to do. But we were able to achieve it. So here we are, spacewalk number 3. This is a view from Drew's helmet opening the doors. Here's that COSTAR instrument. He's pulling that out, refrigerator size. You can see him give a thumbs up when it came out okay. That's because in the training at the pool at the neutral buoyancy laboratory, it never came out well. It always got stuck one way or another. But here you can see Drew is easily handling that 800-pound box as the Earth goes by underneath. It's very, you'd think we would be distracted all the time, but no. So here I am now inside. Drew's my surgeon's assistant, and I'm working on this advanced camera for surveys. This is the most powerful digital camera ever flown in space, and it's failed. And I have to take out these tiny screws, remove a cover plate, and pull out some circuit cards. And so this is well described in the IMAX film as well. We developed a lot of tools. So this is a cover plate that once I actually pull the screws all the way out, I just loosened them by hand, then used a power screwdriver. If you look carefully, you can see some screws floating around in there. And that's a clear plate that kept them captive so they wouldn't float away. And then I had a special tool to pull the cards out. The cards are too sharp to touch by gloved hand because they'd cut through the pressure bladder and then the oxygen would leak out. Bad things happen then. So, like, you know, death. So we didn't want to touch the cards and ruin a perfectly good suit. But the circuit cards came out, and, you know, this is one of those tasks that I just love to do where they say, you know, this is impossible, nobody can do it, and they go, well, let John do it. It's kind of like the Life commercial. Well, let Mikey try it, for those of you who remember it. And I really do like that kind of thing. So you'll see these are my tools coming back in after that spacewalk. You'll see me float in from the airlock in just a minute. And I was just as happy as I've ever been in space. I mean, this was, for me, a huge achievement. And years of stress had come off the next. So I went to bed that night in my sleeping bag. We all sleep in just little Nomex sleeping bags. It's a nylon sleeping bag with eye shades and earplugs. And that's because every 96 minutes, we go through a day-night transition, sunrise and sunset, and so the lights come up and down. So we wear eye shades, so that the earplugs, well, because, you know, people snore in space, too. And the next morning, after, you know, a full 6 hours of sleep, the alarm clock goes off. It's just a little tone that we set. It goes boop, and it tells us to wake up. Once the ground then sees some activity, you know, like the potty firing up, lights turning on, they can see that from Houston. They then play the wake-up music. And it's a tradition that there's wake-up music. Well, you hear it on the ground, on the NASA television. You hear, you know, some great song. And in space, we have a tinny little speaker, and it all sounds like this. And everybody's going, what was it? What was it? Whose day is it? You know, anybody recognize that tune? You know, and eventually somebody on the crew says, you know, that sounds like my favorite song, sort of, so I'll take credit. Thank you for playing, you know, Beatles, you know. Anyway, so that particular morning I slept through the music, didn't hear that either. And finally Megan looks over and says, you know, John hasn't moved yet. I think he's dead. And so Scooter grabs my sleeping bag, shakes the foot, and I go, good morning. You know, best night sleep I've ever had in my life. I was so stress relieved.
It's a lovely day for a launch here live at Cape Canaveral at the lower end of the Florida Peninsula. And the purpose of today's mission is truly, really electrifying.
That's correct, Tom. The lion's share of this flight will be devoted to the study of the effects of weightlessness on tiny screws.
Unbelievable. And just imagine the logistics of weightlessness. And of course, this could have literally millions of applications here on Earth. And everything from watchmaking to watch repair.
So in fact, our mission was dedicated to the study of the behavior of tiny screws in space, because not only did we repair the advanced cameras for surveys with all those tiny screws, that was actually the warm-up for the next day when Mike Massimino would go in, and he had to remove 117 screws. I only had 36. Now, fortunately, mine was around a corner, and I was kind of working blind. His, at least, were right in front of him, but it was still hard access. But in order to get to 113 of those screws, first, he had to remove just a handrail. You know, you saw Drew holding that big refrigerator-sized instrument, holding handrails. Well, one of those yellow handrails blocked the panel that he had to remove the screws from. So the first thing he had to do was just pull off the handrail.
Okay, Drew, I'm having trouble with this one on the lower right. I don't want to strip the thing.
So unfortunately, accidentally, he did strip
that handrail.
And we couldn't get it off. After 4 hours, we had no luck. So finally, the ground said, well, try this. Now, I'm fairly confident that if we had planned a robotic mission, it would not have been able to do that. So the ground had called up and said, well, we think with about 60 pounds of force, if you just yank on it, the bolt will shear in tension, break in tension, and you'll be able to get the handrail off. And Mass said, well, I think I can do that. You know. Now, at this point, he's desperate. I mean, 4 hours into the spacewalk. We were supposed to have gotten to this point at 30 minutes, and it's 4 hours, and we still haven't gotten the stupid handrail off. And there's nothing we can do until we get the handrail off. So he was really thrilled. But now we're 4 hours into the spacewalk. He still has 4 hours more work to do to get the rest of these screws out. So it took a fair amount of discipline to complete it, and we were able to complete it. But what we didn't know on orbit is the reason they knew it was about 60 pounds is on the ground, of course, we have this big team of experts, and they'd done the test. While we were struggling, they built a little fixture, put a handrail on it, got a fish scale, left only one bolt in there, and pulled on it.
Go ahead.
And all I can say is I'm really glad they didn't send that up to us to watch, because there's no way we'd ever have tried that on orbit after seeing this. But we saw it on the ground after we landed, so it's a good, it makes for a good laugh. But they actually pulled them both off with the same result. All that stored energy was suddenly released with the handrail flying off. Fortunately, you know, Massimino was able to hold on to it, and it didn't fly off and puncture his suit. But all of that was to get, in this case, just at one circuit board that had one failed component on it. These are cards about this big, and again, Mike had a special tool. We couldn't touch this. And then when we put the cover back on, we didn't have to put all the screws back in, fortunately. We actually built a system with just two levers that you threw the levers and it grabbed the edges. So we were able to repair both scientific instruments. So this is a first in space, and both are working splendidly. And the STIS instrument, the Space Telescope Imaging Spectrograph, is that instrument that was able to do the studies of the atmosphere of a planet around a nearby star. So we wanted that to work. The next day, we changed out the second of the Hubble's two batteries. We also changed out a fine guidance sensor. I'm on the robotic arm in this case, holding a baby grand size instrument that helps Hubble lock onto guide stars, the other part that allows the laser pointer to hold very steady, or the Hubble to hold very steady on the stars. And Drew is helping me out. And we also changed out some insulation. This particular insulation, I had carried up on two previous missions. This was the third time this piece flew, and I was determined not to bring it back to Earth. And so we actually got up an hour early so I could make sure to finish that. And then finally, with all the work done, here we are flying over the Earth, putting all the tools away, five spacewalks. I give Hubble one last pat and a salute. And then in my suit, I said, "You're the man." and off we go. So the next day, worked one day after another until we could get rid of Hubble. Now that it's working, we didn't break the Hubble. Megan put Hubble back on the end of the payload, on the robotic arm. We let go of Hubble, and then Scott Altman fired the forward-facing thrusters on the space shuttle, which allowed us to back out underneath Hubble. So if you think about us in the capsule, we fired the jets back out under Hubble. Hubble goes over our heads. And so Hubble's distance from our heads is about 11 feet at this point. Now, I've seen this three times. Everybody ducks. You know, what difference does it make? And besides, we're all floating around, but everybody ducks. It's just, you know, this is one of those human things. And off Hubble goes. This is the new, you can barely see it here, but there's a ring here. This is the new docking adapter we put on the bottom of Hubble so a different spacecraft could go to it. And Hubble would just sort of continually drift off in the distance as we watched, and you know, we're all out the window shooting pictures. And it got smaller and smaller. And eventually, a little bit after this, we went into orbital night, and we just saw Hubble turn gold for a moment and then disappear. And that's the last we saw of it. Now, once Hubble's gone, we finally had time to get together as a crew and have a meal. I like to hang upside down like a bat. Now, why not? Drew spent a lot of time perfecting the art of the tortilla. And this is really good in 3D. Now, being scientists on board, and the fact that we couldn't come back to Florida for a couple of days, we finally had a chance to play in space a little bit. This is a ball of water. Now, if you pour water on a countertop, it's going to form a kind of a circular disk. That's because of surface tension. The tension of the water itself will cause it to want to pull together. Well, in space, you don't have the gravitational force pushing it flat, so it forms a sphere. So here's a sphere of water floating in the payload, in the mid-deck of the space shuttle. And I focused on the image inside of there like a lens. It's a spherical lens instead of on Drew. So you can see a distorted, rounded, sort of wide-angle view. But I then asked Drew, get really close to it. Don't let it touch you, but get really close. Let's see what it looks like. So here's a magnified eyeball view. If you ever wanted to look. So, I mean, it's just, you know, one of those little optics tricks. It's a telescope mission after all. He then let it touch him, and of course then surface tension took over and spread out, and he had these water goggles, which was kind of fun. We also got to see a lot of neat physical phenomena on Earth. This is the coast of Africa, and we're traveling, of course, west to east. Here's the Cape Verde Islands, and there's a strong southerly flow of wind going over those islands, and the clouds are just at the height where they get caught by the peak. There's a little island dipping out there, and it causes the wind to swirl around these von Karman vortices, and they just went on for hundreds of miles like that. We would see that orbit after orbit until finally our orbit moved away from being able to see it, but just really neat basic physics. Now there's an urban legend that probably some of you have heard, that the only big structure, human structure, that you can see from space is the Great Wall of China. Well, in fact, I've tried very hard to see the Great Wall of China from space and have not yet seen it, even with very high power binoculars. It is possible to see it, but it's not very tall, and it's made out of exactly the same kind of rock that sits next to it. You know, so there's very little contrast. You know, if you caught it at just the right sun angle, because it's a long linear feature, you might see if there's an elongated shadow, you know, that contrast, but very, very hard to see. But there are many things. In fact, my great surprise is that there's really no place on Earth that we fly over in the space shuttle that you don't see evidence of people, even in the open oceans. So I picked one small example, coincidentally, is maybe of some interest, is Dubai. So for scale, here's the International Airport at Dubai. So that's about 2 miles, a little over 2 miles long. Here's the city. So the city is this gray splotch, kind of a blight on the land, if you will, my editorial commentary. But anyway, I mean, this is where millions of people now live, out on the coast in a desert country. And these are palm trees. I'm sure you recognize that. These are plant communities. You know, so you know about plant communities on the Gulf Coast. Well, these are planned communities on the Dubai coast, and there's two of them. This one is essentially complete. This one's essentially complete. This bigger one is still in development. This is some of the harbor complex, as is here, as a shipping. And you know, this kind of mass, large scale, somewhat over the top development is unsustainable, as they've discovered. But they're still working on one, and this is currently not being worked on, but they got partway. This is actually planet Earth: North America, South America, Africa, Asia, Australia. And this is what it looks like out the window, just with your eyeballs, basically. And this is what happens if you get out the big binos. And so here these are, and here's that Earth, and you can even see a hint of the Earth's limb being poured into sand. Anyway, so this is what it looks like when you look at the Earth. So all of this is human activity, and it's really apparent when you fly over the Middle East and you see, you know, where people and then desert starts, and you know the desert keeps trying to erase the people, and people keep pushing back. It's fascinating to see. Absolutely, the best thing about flying in space is looking back at Earth. It'll be very interesting when crews go to Mars, and after about a week, the Earth is just a tiny spot. Mars is months away from being interesting, and in the meantime, there's nothing to look at but stars. But the nice thing about flying in Earth orbit is you see so many beautiful phenomena. This is a sunrise. Here's the Earth's atmosphere, extraordinarily thin on the scale of the Earth. This is after we deployed Hubble. Now, we also got to do stupid astronaut tricks with the first-time flyers. This is feeding them peanut M&Ms. This is me actually drinking Tang in space. Again, one of those fluid physics experiments. Here's Mike Good, who's in orbit right now, drinking some water. We also examined the stability of solid bodies rotating about various axes and conservation of angular momentum. That's a little small in there, but the effect is still there. Now, while we're down there doing important physics experiments, the guys upstairs were playing video games, figure that. So here's Megan, Ray J, and Scott Altman flying the shuttle landing simulator game, which I encourage them. I filmed these sequences. I encourage them to practice over and over again. He hadn't flown the simulator, real simulator, for 2 weeks, so I want him to fly this. He has a hand controller just like the shuttle one. And finally, after 3 days of getting into our spacesuits, we got the nod to come back, not to Florida, but to California. Scott Altman got in his spacesuit, put on some California tunes, and rocked to those for a little while until Megan said, "I don't think so. Time to get to work." And finally, we did our deorbit burn over the Pacific. You can see we're encased, a night entry, we're encased in this 3,000-degree plasma. As the bottom of the space shuttle becomes a big disk break, dissipating heat from our reentry. And then a few hundred miles from the coast of California, we saw Edwards Air Force Base, Dryden Flight Facility, runway 22. This is the view through the heads-up display. We're going through 12,000 feet, doing about 350 miles per hour. 17 degrees to 21 degrees nose low, three times steeper than a commercial aircraft. At 300 feet, Greg Johnson pushed the landing gear buttons, and fortunately the landing gear came down. And then Scott Altman's job was to place that landing gear over the Earth somewhere safe, hopefully the runway, which he did. Remember, at this point, we're purely a glider. We'd been a glider for 5,000 miles. We put out a chute, not to slow us down, but to make the nose gear not hit so hard. Then after we've gone a little ways, we'll get rid of that space chute so it doesn't get caught in the main engines, apply the brakes, and after traveling 197 orbits around the Earth, we rolled to a stop in California. Five spacewalks, and we did everything that we had brought, plus a little bit more, that extra insulation we hadn't planned to do, and a few other things on Hubble, the complete Hubble makeover. Now, the proof is actually a few months after we land. You know, we didn't think we broke the Hubble, but rule number one is don't break the Hubble, and we don't really know until the first observations are made. So here we go. So in the fall, the first observations came out. This is a globular cluster. Now, globular cluster sounds like some kind of yummy candy, but in fact, it's a collection of about 10 million stars that all formed about the same time. It's kind of an early galaxy. So these formed about 10 billion years ago from collapsing big cloud of gas and dust, a mini galaxy, if you will. And at some point, this mini galaxy was somehow captured by the Milky Way, this much larger spiral galaxy that we live in. So we can observe this with Hubble, all the individual stars. And it's a great thing just to check out a scientific instrument because it's a field with millions of stars. You aim the camera at it, and you can tell if there's systematic distortion or any kind of problems with one part of your detector, your camera being more sensitive than others. So we're able to calibrate it all. And so this is really a boring engineering issue, image for Hubble. This is just an boring picture that we took to help calibrate the instruments. Well, you know, that's not quite true. I mean, we also know that it's pretty. In fact, Greg Johnson, the pilot on the mission, who's not an astronomer, not a scientist, said, wow, looks like Christmas. And it is a really beautiful picture. So this is with the new super-duper wide-field camera, the one we almost didn't get in on Hubble. And so it shows all these stars. Now, the colors of the stars are related to their temperature. The cooler stars are reddish. The hotter stars are bright yellow or white. And the ones in between are in between. And our sun is kind of a yellow in-between star. And the because these are all about the same age, the color also can tell us something about how massive the star is. And so we can learn a lot about how stars are born and live. Now, how are stars born? This is one of the things Hubble has proved to show a lot of evidence in the theory and story of how stars are born. And we now understand that stars are born in these dense molecular clouds. Now, by molecular cloud, what I mean is that this is a cloud filled with atoms of hydrogen. And as we know, cold hydrogen forms atomic bonds to make H2, two hydrogen atoms bound together in a molecule. Because they're in a molecule, we call this a molecular cloud. So most of this cloud is made up of just pure hydrogen. And gravity is causing the cloud to slowly collapse. But because this cloud is actually a little bit older and it's in our galaxy, it also has a little bit of oxygen in it, helium, nitrogen, magnesium, silicon, a tiny bit of iron. And we can tell all of that from the Hubble observations. So this cloud is slowly collapsing. And somewhere in the middle of this dense cloud, we can't see it in this picture, a new star has been born. Just the gas has collapsed far enough, and as it collapses, it heats up, just gravitational energy release. It heats up to the point that at the very center is a very high density, high temperature environment. And suddenly, like a spark, fusion energy turns on. And that's very exothermic. It produces heat. And that heat increases the temperature of the core and increases the rate at which hydrogen burns into helium. And suddenly a star turns on. And that produces light. And the light slowly pushes out on the cloud until eventually the cloud is cleared out and we see the star. Now, we know that's happening because if you look carefully, there's a hint of a kind of a material that's being shot out of this cloud in this direction and a little bit out here. That's evidence of a rotating star that has just formed and is shooting gas out because of its gravity. And so we're guessing a lot. We see this in a lot of different systems and we've pieced together this story. But wouldn't it be cool if we could see into the cloud and see that star forming? Okay. Well, this picture was taken in optical light like our eyeballs. If we were Superman and we had X-ray vision, we could see into it. Well, the physics of that is all wrong. In fact, X-rays tend not to, they penetrate nicely through our bodies in X-ray machines, but they don't penetrate through a lot of gas like this very well. But it turns out infrared light does. Infrared light has a longer wavelength, and it can sneak between the dust, and we can see in here. So one of the things we installed on Hubble this time was an infrared camera. So there it is. There's the baby star. Here's those jets of material. And we can see through. Here's the ghostly veil of that, still some of that glowing hydrogen and hydrogen gas. We see a lot of other things that we didn't see before as well. But in principle, we can now see these stellar nurseries. So because it's illustrative, I'll go back and forth a little bit. So there's the normal visible view. There's the infrared. And so this is a brand new capability for Hubble. It's also just kind of fun to flip between them like that and see all the things you can see. So that's stellar birth. That's a stellar nursery. And we were like that at one point. Not exactly like that, but more or less that's how the solar system formed. And I told you there's all that gas and dust, and the dust is what keeps us from seeing the star in the visible. That dust is some of what forms a disk around the new star and eventually forms planets. And it looks like it only takes about 10 million years or so for the first planets to start forming after a star turns on, which in a 13 billion year old universe is nothing. So that's where stars and planetary systems come from. Now, okay, if that's star birth, what happens when stars die? This is at the other end. So inside of, you can't see it here because there's too much dust and it doesn't have the infrared view. But inside of here is a star about 5 times more massive than our sun. It's used up all of its hydrogen inside the core of the star. And it's starting to burn not hydrogen fusion, but helium fusion. And it turns out that that's kind of a rough process and produces energy in a way that causes the star to expel its outer envelope. It basically belches. And in that belch, sends material flying out into space, into the area between stars. So here's one that was probably 10 or 20,000 years ago. And you can see a shock front, it's called. And back here is another one. And then here's the most recent one. And so these are big belches. And these are traveling at 600,000 miles an hour out. And the star will continue to do that until it's expelled a lot of material. And then we'll either end in a massive supernova explosion where the star blows itself to smithereens, or just totally runs out of energy, cools off, and becomes kind of an ember of a star. And so that's what happens at the end of a star's life. This is generically called a nebula, planetary nebula. But it has nothing to do with planets. It's just in early telescopes it looked kind of like a solar system or a planet. So there's lots of these, and we see many examples. Now, I said sometimes a star will blow itself to smithereens. Basically, the star will run out of energy. Gravitational pull will cause the star to collapse till it's really, really in a tight bunch and packed into areas so close that it exceeds nuclear density and then rebounds, the density of a nucleus rebounds in this massive explosion. And this is a really lousy picture, I apologize. It's a ground-based photo, not a Hubble photo. But you see all this purple gas? That's what's left over after one of these stars blows up. So we can use Hubble and look at that gas. So this little square represents this new cosmic origin spectrograph looking at gas inside of that square. Now, the cosmic origin spectrograph doesn't produce nice images. What it does is to break light up into its component colors like a prism. So if we were to break the component colors up, this is at the bluer end and this is going towards the redder end, what we see are peaks of light. So this would be a single color of light. And here's another color of light and a single band of light. And each one of these corresponds to a given collection of atoms of a certain type glowing in this nebula. And what we see is carbon and oxygen. These lines represent carbon and oxygen atoms glowing at a certain temperature. Now, I want you all to take a big breath. Okay, I heard most of you breathing, so I know some fraction of you are still alive. All of that oxygen that we just breathed in, every single atom was created inside of a star. That's where it came from. And the way it got to us was through a supernova explosion. In fact, to account when we're carbon-based life forms, all of the carbon in our bodies was formed inside of a star and had to go through a supernova explosion. And in fact, if you look at what's made up in our body, how many people take a zinc in their multivitamins? Zinc. How about iron? Is iron important? Yeah, it's what makes our blood red. It carries oxygen in the bloodstream. Copper, we need a little bit of copper, selenium, all these things. In order to account for all those things that we need to survive, we had to be processed through two and a half or three supernova explosions. Otherwise, there wouldn't be enough stuff on Earth to support complex life like us. Now, we only know that because we know what the human body is made of, and we can go back through it. But pretty phenomenal. Carl Sagan said we are stars made of star stuff, and it's absolutely true. And so we're able to probe that with the Hubble Space Telescope with instruments like this. Now, the other cool thing Hubble's able to do is to look back to the farthest universe. Now, it can do this, and ground-based telescopes can't do this, by staring in one place for days and never get bored. That's the wonderful thing about robotic spacecraft. You tell it to look, it'll look forever. And it's like taking a time-lapse picture. You know, for folks who used to use film, like me, you know, you'd open the shutter for a long time to see dim things. Well, we do that with Hubble. And if we look back with this new super-duper wide-field camera with the infrared capability, what we see in this photo is this thing with the spikes on it, that's a star in our own galaxy. So if you see something like that, it's a star in our own galaxy. There's one of those in this photo. Everything else in this picture is another galaxy. Now, to give you the perspective, if I hold my pinky up on the sky, actually, if I hold a soda straw, a drinking straw, up on the sky at arm's length and look through it, that's how big this picture is. It's a tiny fraction of the sky. But if you had sensitivity like Hubble, Hubble's eyeball, if you will, close one eye because we only have one Hubble, and look up at the sky, if you could be as sensitive as Hubble, which is about a trillion times more sensitive than human eye, this is what you would see. And every one of these spots, even these tiny little ones, is a galaxy with 50 to 400 billion stars in it. And most of these are quite far away. Now, we measure how far away things are using a measuring stick, a yardstick, that's called a light year. That's how far light travels in 1 year. It's an enormous distance, millions and millions of miles. Well, I've circled several of these, the green ones, and we label them by the redshift, but that's just another measure. The green ones have a redshift between 6.5 and 7. That means that we're seeing the galaxies, the light that left these galaxies left 10 billion years ago. These few here, the 5 that are in yellow, the light left 13 billion years ago. So these galaxies, we're seeing them as they existed because it took that long for the light to get to us. We're seeing them as they existed only 600 to 700 million years after the universe was created in this Big Bang. This is kind of how we know it. Now, they're not really good-looking galaxies because Hubble's just not able to resolve them. They're spots. You know, these spots, and we infer through the physics that they're this far away. And so when you actually image them, you know, they kind of have elongated shapes, but you can't see the individual stars. The next telescope, James Webb Space Telescope, that we're going to build and launch in 2015, hopefully we'll be able to look at these in more detail. But these really are the toddler galaxies. You know, they're not quite infant galaxies. We don't know how far back we can push this. But we have now the capability from the vicinity of the Earth and human beings to build telescopes that can see the first galaxies and the first stars in the universe. And I just think that's phenomenal. When you think back 80 years ago, how I started the talk, Edwin Hubble, they didn't even know we lived in a galaxy that wasn't here forever and will last forever. You know, there was no talk about the start of a galaxy, even though philosophers for millennia had talked about, you know, creation of universes, creation of the Earth, and all this kind of thing. So philosophically, we're answering these fundamental questions for the first time in human history with real data. And I'm a very data-driven guy. You know, I like to know the answer to things. So are we alone? Well, I'll know when we meet somebody from, you know. Now, I just want to sort of end with one last topic, because this is really my favorite topic, and I'll be making Hubble observations related to this in my new job. But this is Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9. How many people remember this? So a few. So Hubble's vision was blurry, and NASA was the embarrassment of the country. And we sent people, women and men, in white spacesuits to ride to the rescue of NASA and fix the Hubble Space Telescope. And just 6 months later, we discovered that a comet, Shoemaker-Levy 9, was about to hit Jupiter. The gravitational pull of Jupiter was breaking it into pieces. So these are the pieces, the string of pearls, that used to be one comet that's now all these little pieces that slammed into Jupiter and created these massive scars on that gas giant. Each one of these corresponds to one of those comet pieces hitting Jupiter. Now, Jupiter's a big place, 1,000 times more massive than the Earth. And it had a big effect on Jupiter. And the astronomical community thought, wow, we are so lucky that, number one, we're around to see this event, because this is an extraordinarily rare event. and that we just fixed the Hubble Space Telescope so it could make pictures like this, because if it was blurry, we wouldn't have these nice images. And the reason why astronomers felt so lucky is the estimate is that this kind of thing only happens once in 1,000 or once in every 10,000 years, that something hits Jupiter like that. Because the solar system's pretty much been cleaned out. Everything's organized into nice pieces. You know, we have the 8 planets. We have Pluto and the rest of the Oort cloud, as it's called, all the other stuff that's way out there that we don't worry about, the occasional comet that sweeps through, and then the asteroid belt. And you know, around Earth, it's pretty safe. I mean, things don't hit the Earth very often. Well, unless you go to Arizona and Meteor Crater, and Canada and the craters there, and Australia and South Africa. And well, there's lots of craters on Earth, too. But we have plate tectonics that erases that, so we don't worry about it. But anyway, so we were so lucky to see this once-in-a-lifetime, at least, event on Jupiter. And so that's pretty thrilling. Anyway, so we go back up. We do our complete Hubble makeover 15 years later. 3 months later, something hits Jupiter. So now we know that, in fact, it's not, you know, once in a millennia. It's once every few Hubble missions. So if we just keep servicing Hubble, we'll see more of this. But actually, now we know, with the best data we have available, it's about once every 15 years. Well, with 2 data points, that's the best you can say. But it's not uncommon. Things must hit Jupiter frequently. Now, Comet Shoemaker-Levy 9, when it was making a previous sweep through the solar system, it was predicted that it would hit Jupiter because it was entrapped in an orbit that Jupiter had already preordained that eventually it would spiral in and hit Jupiter. This one, nobody ever saw it coming. It's a very different animal. Comets are these dirty ice balls. This, from the analysis, looks like it was an asteroid, a rocky body that hit Jupiter. Now, you might say this is all very interesting stuff, you know, but are we just arranging the deck chairs on the Titanic here? You know, is this important for us on planet Earth? You know, or is it just a bunch of academics studying distant objects? Well, to give you a sense of scale and perspective, this is how big the Earth is. This is how big the object scar on Jupiter is. If this had hit us, I never would have made it here today. So this would be a big deal. You know, maybe not a dinosaur extinction event level, but certainly the kind of thing that could wipe out a continent, which, you know, if it happened to hit us, would be a big deal. You know, France, I don't know. So I hope there's nobody here from France. You're not recording this, are you? So, but anyway, clearly this would be a big event anywhere on planet Earth, even if it hit the oceans, anywhere in the oceans, and it would create tidal waves and the kind of throwing moisture, water vapor into the atmosphere that would dramatically change our climate. I don't want to scare you guys too much. That's pretty scary. But then I spent so many nights thinking how you did me wrong. And I grew strong. And I learned how to get along. And so you're back from out of space. I just walked in to find you here with that sad look upon your face. Weren't you the one who tried to hurt me with goodbye? You think I crumbled? You think I'd lay down and die? Oh, no, not I. I will survive. Okay, so in all seriousness, we shouldn't get too complacent here on planet Earth. We haven't really been around all that long. And in fact, this is an observation. It was made by David Jewett at UCLA with Hubble, January 29th, 2010, so just about 3 weeks after I took my job. And he sent in a note saying, using an asteroid survey, actually looking for near-Earth objects, survey telescope that MIT runs called the Linear Telescope, he'd observed something that he'd never seen before, and it looked like maybe an asteroid belt comet or possibly two asteroids that had collided. And we've never seen that before. It must happen all the time. That's kind of why they're out there and they're broken up bits of planets, but we've never actually seen that. And so he asked Matt Mountain and myself, the directors, for discretionary time to point Hubble at it and see what it is. And we thought, yeah, this is probably worthwhile, you know, if it is an asteroid collision. And in fact, so this is the picture with that wide field camera 3, super duper digital camera. And it indeed sort of has a cometary tail, but there's this funny business going on at this end. And when you zoom in on it, it in fact looks like two meteors, this one in particular, a very large object that might be a few kilometers across. or at least hundreds of meters, hit something else and obliterated it. And when we do spectroscopy, in fact, we see silicates indicating that's what's happened. We see rocky material. And this is just light pressure from the sun spreading it out. And so we've now seen an example of two asteroids that have hit that have changed their trajectories like billiard balls. Now, these are going to stay out there. But it's entirely possible, and in fact, the leading theory is that something like this happened 65 million years ago that kicked something to the inner solar system that hit the Earth, hit where what is now present-day Yucatan, and changed the Earth's climate enough that it wiped out the land species, the dinosaurs. So that kind of stuff happens. You know, we can't predict it, and it's probably, you know, we're doing surveys. Many people are doing surveys, and there's nothing around now that'll kill us for sure anytime soon. That we know of and that we're willing to tell everybody. We don't want you to panic. But anyway, in NASA's new plan that the president has outlined, one of the ideas is to go visit one of these near-Earth objects. If we in fact do that, it would be very interesting. And to me, it would send a signal for all of us that, hey, we can actually go out to one of these things, visit it, and in principle change its trajectory slightly, demonstrating for the first time in human history that we can make better decisions than the dinosaurs. I think that would be a big hallmark. So, astronomically speaking, this is Hubble, 1980. It was really started late 75, but construction started in 1980. The next big project is the James Webb Space Telescope. We started construction in 2000. It should launch 2014, maybe 2015. And my hope is that this will be extraordinarily successful and we'll move on to build not a telescope that's 200 times more powerful than Hubble, but even much more so. Maybe this is a 6.5 meter telescope. If we could build a 16 or 20 meter telescope in space, this would allow us, in principle, to answer the question of whether we're alone or not. It would be able to see Earth-like planets around nearby stars with enough spectral resolution, the physics capability, to look at the atmosphere and see if there's oxygen, whether it's carbon dioxide, maybe pollution. If we see fluorocarbons, which are not a naturally occurring compound in the universe that we know of, if we see fluorocarbons, we can actually confirm that there's complex life on the planet, and we can rule out intelligent life. With that, I'd like just to say thanks for your kind attention. And the cool thing about this Hubble story is with the complete makeover we just did, the Hubble story is actually just beginning, and we're going to see some fantastic science out of it.
So we have time for a few questions.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you for a spectacular view for humanity and for a magnificent lecture. With your background in physics and your remarkable experiences in space, and all your and just all that you've enjoyed, your incredible lifestyle, is there any potential at all for a magnetic engine in the future? Years ago, Hughes was looking at magnetic power, magnetic engines. Is anything possible for magnetic energy for space travel?
Okay, so without getting on a soapbox that'll keep you here till well past 9, there are actually a lot of interesting ideas related to magnetic propulsion, if you will. People have talked about rail guns for military purposes or for launching missiles. And in fact, there have been a lot of demonstrations that are kind of magnetic levitation, and then you use a magnetic wave like surfing to accelerate a spacecraft. And you could, in fact, launch things from the surface of the Earth using that, but they tend to have acceleration profiles, that would flatten a human. So it might be good for getting cargo to orbit or for spent nuclear fuel into a solar orbit. But there are various states of matter that we know about. So there's solids, liquids, gases, and the plasma. Now, plasma is what happens when you have a gas of atoms and you separate the nuclei and the electrons. You get this charged gas, if you will. And they have their own peculiar properties. But one of the things you can use is the fact that you have charged things is to use magnetism, to accelerate the plasma in a magnetohydrodynamic engine. And in fact, Franklin Chang Diaz, a former astronaut and fellow physicist, has been building one of those. And if you could combine a kind of magnetic nozzle like that with a fusion engine, a nuclear fusion engine, then suddenly the solar system becomes accessible to us. And you're not talking about travel times to Mars of 6 or 8 months, travel times to Saturn of 10 years. Suddenly you're talking about 5 days to Mars, a month to Saturn. And only until we have that will we actually go out and truly explore the solar system. Before that time, you know, we're going to be making the long march like Oregon Trail, you know, and really difficult trips chemically. So there's some hope. So I think Ian is going to invent that technology. Oh, really? How about, yes?
How do you get your mind around these incredible numbers and distances and things that exist, and what holds it all up out there?
Thanks.
In fact, I don't think anybody really has a good handle on how. I mean, I think the universe is still somewhat unfathomable. I mean, just distances, you know, that we can't imagine. You know, and so we just do our best to think about, you know, analogs of, you know, well, if, you know, if the universe were on my desk, you know, how, what's the distance between galaxies? And, you know, we just don't live long enough, you know, with approximately 100-year lifespans, you know, the distances that we could travel at reasonable speeds and things we can think about. And that's what's so phenomenal about the Hubble Space Telescope is, and even though we can't go to these places, and it's inconceivable, as you heard me say, that people will ever go to another galaxy using anything of what we know now, but we can go there every day with Hubble. But it's still, the numbers are just incredible. I mean, although, that being said, you know, I talked about how many stars we think are in our galaxy, 400 billion stars. That's a lot of stars. And I would say when I was in high school, that number was an inconceivably large number to me. Okay? Well, it only takes us about 3 months to spend $400 billion on gasoline and oil in this country, all of which goes offshore. And $400 billion is no longer a big number in money. So I don't know why. I guess I don't know why I'm impressed that it's a big number in stars, but you know, everything changes. Yes.
Yeah. Hi. In starting in 1980 until the Hubble was launched, I worked on the Hubble for Lockheed Missiles and Space Company in Sunnyvale, California, and I was a chief project coordinator on it. And I want to tell you what a great job you guys have done. It's just wonderful. And I want to also remark on you personally have given the best presentation I have ever heard on this, yeah, including the IMAX, which I saw just yesterday.
Oh, I'm glad you saw that. Because we have scenes from Sunnyvale.
Super sense of humor.
Thanks. Well, thank you for doing such a great job building the telescope. And there are some key characteristics to projects like this. You got to ask, why is the Hubble so successful? Why are we celebrating, you know, 20 years on orbit? When other projects, you know, the most recent example is Project Constellation. I find the Constellation motivation absolutely compelling. You know, let's build some new spacecraft, let's use it to leave low Earth orbit and go explore. Let's go to the moon and learn what we need to learn so we can go beyond. Let's go to Mars, find out if it's a place we want to live, push beyond. I mean, how more compelling can you get than that? But we can't seem to keep it going long enough to get it successful. And we tend to develop systems that are so complex we can't afford them. But Hubble wasn't like that. Now, there were predecessors to Hubble that were built at Sunnyvale and similar telescopes, so it wasn't the first of its kind, but nevertheless, the Hubble was able to capture the public imagination that allowed it to have sustainability over generations. And I think it's partly because we had human crews going up there, people, you know, like me and my crewmates, that can give it an extra life, add some story, some chapters to the drama. But part of it that enabled us to go up there is because while you were building the telescope, you kept the data. You took good pictures. We were able to go back. And when something failed, you know, flip open the pictures from Sunnyvale and say, okay, you know, this is the screw we have to turn. The wiring bundle goes this way, you know, and study those in a way that we were successful. If we hadn't have captured that knowledge from the early parts of the project, we never could have done this hard stuff. And that's part of the systems engineering we have to learn on the new spacecraft. So,
time for one more question.
I have two questions. One is, what are we going to... What?
good trick. I like that. Yeah.
What's going to happen with Hubble now that with the retiring of the shuttle? Second question, what's the most dangerous aspect of the spacewalking when you guys are out there? Maybe the third question is... just human requirement. What happens? You have to go to the toilet, or you have to go to relieve yourself. You're out there for six hours.
You know those porta potties? Okay, so I'll answer the last one first. The longest I've been in a spacesuit is about 12 hours, and it is possible to hold it. And in fact, for a simple reason, we climb into the space. First of all, you know, it's like your mom said, you know, go before you get in the car, will ya? No? I don't know. So, okay. So you got to remember that. But you want to be well hydrated, because bad things in space happen if you're not well hydrated. So even that doesn't help. But as soon as you get into the spacesuit and you're all buttoned up, we purge all of the air out of the suit and replace it with pure oxygen. And that's because we're about to go down in pressure. We don't want to get the bends. You know, it's like diving, but the reverse. We're going to empty the air out of the airlock and go down in pressure, so you don't want nitrogen bubbles to form. So we purge our bodies to try and get as much oxygen as we can. Now, this is dry oxygen. So the only moisture that's in the suit is from us sweating, and you try not to develop a workload, so you sweat a lot. So this dry oxygen is circulating around, and in fact, the CO2 absorber is also taking moisture out from your breath, is taking that out as well, and the suit has a little motor that slurps out the moisture. So it's a very dry environment in the suit. And so you tend to lose about 2 liters of fluid just breathing over a 6 or 8 hour period. And so there's not a lot being sent to your kidneys and to your bladder. So unless you have to go when you get in the suit, there's a good chance that you'll be able to make it 6 or 8 hours without having to pee. Now, strangely, though, that being said, every time I get out of the suit, I got to pee right away. and there's physiological reasons for that. But just in case, we wear diapers. So, you know, astronauts do wear diapers. They happen to be like those Depends. And, okay, risk. We used to think that almost all of the risk in a space mission like the shuttle was allocated to launch. Because why? You have all this chemical energy being released over a short time, you know, violent shaking, engines, all kinds of things that can go wrong. But when we actually did the detailed math, the risk is equally split between launch, orbit, and landing, or entry. It's just the timing difference. You know, the launch is over 8.5 minutes, but it accounts for a third of the overall risk, almost no matter how long the mission is. So that's high risk for a short time. The orbital risk is mostly dominated by getting hit by some piece of orbital debris. And that's true in the spacesuits. Now, in the space shuttle, if we get hit, you probably survive if it's not too big. You can stay in about a half-inch hole in the shuttle and still make it home just fine. It would be an emergency deorbit. But we have extra tanks that can sustain that long enough for us to get home. But in the spacesuit, if you get hit, you know, that's it. Now, fortunately, the odds are pretty low. And you're not only outside for 6 or 8 hours, and the shuttle shields half of the sky, you know. So, but that's probably the highest risk. The second highest is that you physically tear, you know, you do something, catch a sharp edge, tear the suit, and if it's too big, you know, you won't be able to make it back in. Now, the suit has some capability, again, for a quarter-inch hole or so tear. You know, the suit can sustain that long enough for you to scurry back in as fast as you can. But, you know, it's a harsh environment. I mean, it's amazing at all that we go out in these cloth suits, rubber-coated, you know, cloth and Gore-Tex and ceramic fiber and work in these harsh environments. But, you know, we've been pretty safe and we're careful. You know, you're cognizant that, you know, if you do something stupid, you know, use your hand as a hammer, you know, that you could die. So you don't do that. Now, when one person did, they punched a hole in their glove. Fortunately, it was tiny. So you don't, and dumb thing to do. But, you know, that's sort of the riskiest thing. And then entry, we never really thought about until we lost Columbia. And we realized, you know, it took all that energy to get us to space. You got to get rid of that energy coming back. And it's really the same energetics. It's just spread out over a longer time. So we didn't really realize how risky that is. And now we know. You know, we're lucky we've never had a heat shield that's burned through on a Soyuz or on the Apollo Gemini Mercury craft, although we worried about it back then. But, I mean, the same thing is true in the Gulf and risk in oil platforms, that the time between accidents, serious accidents, tend to be very long. And we kind of forget about how risky these things are. We get complacent, and then something really horrible happens. And so I'm just hoping we can fly the next two, that we can get this shuttle crew back safely, fly two more safely, and then build the next system, learning from our mistakes, and that it's safer.
On that optimistic theme, let's thank our speaker.
And I can answer the last one.